Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to today's webinar, How to Successfully Manage and Lead a Virtual Team, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Adler, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Friedrich Butler, one of our GUAA coaching partners. Before we get started, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. First, this webinar is being recorded and it will be made available to all registrants within 3 days of this broadcast on our YouTube channel. Additionally, I will be passing along the link to the recording of this presentation in my follow-up webinar email. I will also include further details on the GUAA Coaching Partnership Program in my webinar follow-up email. Second, questions are welcome and encouraged throughout today's webinar. Please type them in the questions area of the GoToWebinar system as you have them in real time throughout the presentation. Friedrich will stop a few times throughout her presentation to take questions, and we will also have time for questions at the end of the presentation. Friedrich really wants us to be a participatory webinar, so please send in questions and comments along the way. Additionally, we'll be using the polling feature of GoToWebinar, so be on the lookout for those polls, and please do take a few seconds to participate. Finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area as well. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter. Friedrich Butler helps emerging leaders of all ages to build powerful teams, to lead with their unique strengths, and to find joy and purpose in what they do. Her company, Butler Communication, offers leadership learning labs, intercultural training for global leaders, and one-on-one executive coaching. Friedrich's clients range from senior executives at NASA to managers on overseas assignments at the FDA to emerging talent at Lockheed Martin, Micron, and Mars, as well as individual entrepreneurs and visionaries who are in the process of turning their ideas into actions and want a thought partner and candid coach by their side to accelerate the process. Friedrich, we're so excited to hear from you today, so I'm going to turn everything over to you now.
Thank you very much. And to make this a true virtual experience, I also want to give everybody the opportunity to see me and experience my energy and see what my current environment looks like. So this seminar will be, or webinar will be, in true form to be participating. So it's not only about the content that I'm going to deliver, but it's also how I deliver it. So not only pay attention to what I say, but also how I'm trying to engage with you and how I'm going to bring the big world, hopefully, into my office today. So I see that we have a ton of attendees already online. Thank you very much for taking time out of your busy days. And please just send a quick hello so that I can see who's online. Send me a quick, hey, I'm calling in from Fairfax or from Washington, D.C. or maybe Seattle or anywhere else in the world. So let me know who's online. Before I start with the content of the seminar, I wanted to give you a little bit of a background story about me and what gets me so excited about virtual work and creating virtual teams. Back in the days, I was managing a German cruise line, actually not the cruise line, but I opened a sales office for a German cruise line here in the United States. And I was so excited. I thought I was on the top of my game. And we had seven river vessels in Europe that were just fantastic. And my charge was to send as many Americans over to Europe to experience our product and to the beautiful rivers. And I had written the winning proposal. I thought everything was great. I had visited the ships. I was so in love with the product. And of course, I'm from Europe, I'm from Germany. And I was so excited to send people over to see my home country and to really experience it from our best side. So fast forward a year into our really hard work to put great packages together. And I was so excited to, and waiting 3 weeks into the cruise season, waiting for our first feedback forms to come back from our passengers. And lo and behold, they start to arrive. I'm so excited, opening the envelopes, and here comes the evaluation. Ship 5 stars, service 3 stars, food 2 stars, excursion 4 stars, overall 4 star. And I'm like, wow, that's not what I expected, but maybe that's a fluke. So I keep opening envelope after envelope, and it's the same story. People are in love with the ship and the ambiance and the destination. They are not happy about the service and about the food. And my heart really sank, and I had a knot in my stomach. And I finally decided, after a week of following those evaluations and realizing that this is a trend and not just a fluke, I picked up the phone, called the first passengers that had returned and said, tell me more about your vacation. What was really great? What stood out? What would you want us to do differently? And what I heard was a classic misunderstanding of cultural preferences. And the biggest lesson learned was people expected to have dinner as a more or less as a transaction, nice food, quick in and out, and then what's the entertainment for the evening? And on our German ship's dinner was the entertainment of the evening. It was eight courses, and that spaced out so that people could converse in the pauses and really get to know their fellow passengers, and just a completely different dining culture. So the virtual team effort that then had to start was to get everybody on board, headquarters, our American office, the staff on the ships, and all the comments that had come in needed to get addressed. And we did it. It was a year of constant tweaking, communication, overcoming cultural barriers and differences. And in the next year, we won the Condé Nast Travel Award, five-star travel award. And we're really proud. But without really being aware of how can we create a sense of urgency with all the different stakeholders all over the place that hardly ever shared the same space, how can we make our problems known and visible to everybody so that we can design a solution that works, that was really at stake. And I'm happy to report that we did it in the end. So that's the background. And then I built my coaching business and my consulting business for intercultural communication and intercultural training on that experience, and a ton of training then came after that. So without further ado, I invite you to join me in the exploration of what does it take to build a successful team. So let me turn off my webcam so I'm not going to be distracting to you anymore, and we'll get right started with the content. And I will check in with you, and please do send in questions, and we will address them as we come along or at the very end. So now I'm experiencing a little bit of a technical issue that I will address, in that my screen is not moving forward. Okay. There we go. So we have a session overview. I tried to keep it simple for everyone so that we're not overwhelmed. We have three parts of our session today. First, we will talk about three myths and three mega mistakes in virtual team leadership. We will talk about an assessment of your virtual leadership effectiveness and what you can do to assess it and to potentially improve it. And then finally, we'll talk about next steps to move forward and expand your growth as a virtual leader. And the very end, we'll recap all the wonderful information. There will be some resources on the screen, and we'll have time for Q&A. So three myths and three mega mistakes in virtual team leadership. The first myth that I want to present is people think you need vastly different skill sets for building a virtual team than working with a team under one roof. And I personally believe that nothing could be further from the truth, because virtual team leadership really will highlight whether you are a good team leader to begin with. And it all starts with yourself and your ability with working with others. And it's really not a difference whether you work with them in the same office, under the same roof, or whether that is globally. It starts with yourself, with your emotional intelligence and how you relate to others, how you can bring them in on your project or on the issues that you're working on, your technical expertise, so that's the professional IQ, as I call it, and last but not least, your execution intelligence. How organized are you? How well do you design processes in order to execute on the ideas that you have? All of that then comes in the context of the use of technology. How do you interact with people in meetings, and how do you communicate with them outside of the meetings? And these days, another big topic really is generational differences. How do you communicate with people at the workplace that have vastly different motivation? So some people are motivated by progression. Some people are motivated by getting new challenges put on their desk. So you have and between the different generations, you have differences of communicating. So that is becoming more important in the workplace. All of that is just team leadership skills, and it comes down to communication. When we look at virtual team leadership challenges, there's a layer on top of that. And the first layer is cultural differences. Cultural differences doesn't necessarily mean different countries. It can be cultural differences just between how do you operate by yourself in a telecommuting environment, or how does somebody communicate and act and operate on the East Coast or the West Coast. So that needs to be taken into consideration, which then also brings us to time zones. So that sometimes adds a different layer of what is a good time for everybody to come together virtually and meet, and how do we account for different time zones. And then last but not least, the language barriers. If you're operating in a global environment and you're working with people in, let's say, China or the Middle East, and English is not the first language, sometimes saying the same words or using the same terminology doesn't necessarily mean that you mean the same thing. So there's definitely an added layer of challenge there. But in the end, it still starts with yourself and your ability to bring the team together and your ability to communicate. So I hope the first myth is busted. Virtual teams are less efficient than in-house teams. There are so many studies that actually prove the contrary, and we will talk about that. But let's look at, first of all, look at the common complaints in virtual teams or with telecommuting that result in efficiencies. First of all, it's poor communication technology, or challenges in communication technology. As we realized, wow, we have somebody calling in from Ecuador. That is so awesome. So poor communication technology can really make it challenging to listen to each other, or if you have a delay in processing, that can be really challenging. Lack of trust and unproductive dialogue. 50% of participants in virtual teams claim that as a big challenge. Lack of trust can be you don't feel understood, or the communication is too direct or too indirect. So that creates tension between team participants. Big one here is distracted team members during virtual meetings. Have you ever been part of a virtual meeting where you had a feeling that half of the folks are actually answering email while they're supposed to discuss an issue? I certainly have been part of those meetings, and it is very, it really is results in inefficiency because they are missing important information. And then the sense of whether it is true or not that remote team members are loafing and are not doing their share. So 34% of the people that were polled complained about that and said that that's definitely an issue. So let's go back to the graphic that you're already familiar with, and let's look at how we can turn those challenges into opportunities so that you just flip the coin and look at it. How can that actually be a differentiator and an advantage that I just have to leverage? So let's look at cultural differences. With cultural differences, you also have different perspectives. If you allow all the voices and invite all the voices to be heard, you will see that from a different place in the organization or from a different place in the country or around the world, problem solving is handled very differently. When those voices can be heard, it releases creativity, it invites innovation, and you will be alerted if a message just does not work in a different environment. So just very important to pay attention to cultural differences, to be inquisitive about it, curious about it, and utilize them. Really take them to your advantage to set your team apart. Generational differences work similarly. Appreciate different perspectives and really invite them in. There is no, I always say in a cultural space, there is no right or wrong. It's just different. And it's a matter of figuring out together what approach, what way, what goal is the most beneficial for the context. And then institutional knowledge is for, you know, the older generation who has been around quite a long time within one organization or collecting experiences from different organizations. That is absolutely important information to have and to leverage and to mine, as well as fresh ideas from somebody who just comes off school and maybe has cutting edge research to offer or brand new ideas. And bringing that together and leveraging really will result, if you do it well, it will result in innovation. Time zones is a beautiful thing because you can essentially, if you have a global team, you can essentially create a 24/7 workforce. If projects can be handed over well, you can move them from one desk to on the East Coast to the West Coast to Asia, all around the globe, and sometimes problems get solved overnight while you're sleeping and you come back to the office and somebody has found a solution. So it's just something that that can truly work to your benefit, and it also makes you more accessible for customers. And last but not least, I actually, language barriers invite forced simplification. And what I mean with that is sometimes when we're experts in our field, we tend to use very big words. We are so proud to display our knowledge of complex issues and we get lost in language in that. When I have a client where English is not the first language, or maybe it's the third language, then I am forced to use language and use words that are simple, which forces me to really drill down on what is it really that I want to say? What's my main message here? And how can I express it in a way that is easy for the other person to understand? And sometimes very complex situations or scenarios can be expressed in a much, much simpler form. Just think, for example, Einstein's relativity theory. You can fill whole chalkboards with the proofs, but it really comes down to a very simple formula. And if language barriers force you to come to the simplest denominator, that can actually in situations be a really, really good thing. So let's move into myth number three. And if you have any comments about what I'm talking about, please feel free to post them online. I have the running commentary on the side, and I'm trying to keep an eye on that as well. So myth number three is the success of a virtual team is driven by technology. So easy to fall into that trap. And there's so much out there. You have, you know, all these different technologies, platforms, online tools that are there to help facilitate your projects. It is very easy to fall into the trap to look for a solution in technology for virtual team creation. Technology is only a tool, and it's not the answer to create team cohesion. So this is a good place before we move into our mistakes. This is a good place to stop and see if anybody has feedback on the first couple of myths. And Sarah, you have in the meantime run a poll on who is online. I would love to hear from you before we go into the next segment. What kind of virtual teams you are working with, and whether it's a local virtual team with telecommuting, whether it's a virtual team that is national or global. So I would love to get some feedback on that.
Sure, absolutely. Thank you so much, everybody, for sharing too where you're calling in from and joining from. As Friedrich said, yeah, we have someone from Ecuador, we've got people from California, Portland, Oregon, here in DC, Virginia. So thank you all just so much for taking the time to join us today. Friedrich, a couple of questions that have come in. First one, you say that technology is the key to solving the myth, or is not the key to solving the myth? If so, then what is the key?
The key is really relationship building, and in our next segment, we'll address that specifically. But technology is just the tool to be able to connect with others. So technology needs to be simple. Everybody needs to be able to use it. So if you have, the more complex your technology is and the more variance you have in ability of your team members to utilize it, the more you will lose efficiency. So sometimes the simplest is the best. And it's really just a way to connect with each other and a way to share information. It needs to work. It needs to be robust. You need to be able to trust it, and it needs to be able to support the processes. But it is not the solution to make you successful.
Got it. And then another question, how do you create a sense of urgency with all of this, a sense of needing to solve these problems?
Oh, that is a great question. And that really starts with a shared of understanding what the issue is and a clear managing of expectations, what the desired results are. And we'll all address that in the next segment as well. So we'll have some more time to talk about that. Thank you for those questions. Those are really, really excellent. So let me move on and hopefully address those two in greater detail. So our next block of three is mega mistakes that are easy to make as you're building your team or working with a virtual team. And mega mistake number one is focusing mostly on delegation and quality control. I see that a lot with managers that are not at a leadership level, but really more coming at it from a management perspective. And it's all about, I'm going to give you something, and since I don't trust that you're really doing it, I'm going to check in with you constantly, and it really turns into micromanaging very, very quickly, which is frustrating for the person who has been given the task, because they feel like they're constantly being pinged of, where are you with that project, what's going on, and it really speaks more, a lot of times, of an insecurity of the manager than the person not doing their job. So before we go into a possible solution, I would love to spend just a couple of minutes on talking about team typologies, because different communication styles work better or not as elegantly in different contexts. So first of all, you have a leader-directed communication style or process communication style, where the leader just pushes information out and requirements and then collects back the product that is being produced. That is really great when it's really just a process and you have a bunch, without being derogatory, having worker bees working for you, and it's really only about the results. So, you give them something at the end of the day you collect. That works really well and is efficient. Working groups is where you allow the members to work with each other, to use each other as a resource, but the leader is still at the center of it, issues directives, collects, double checks with people, and that works well when issues are a little bit more complex, but it's still, people are in charge of their own tasks. The next team structure is that the leader is part and a member of the team, is also working on the product, and there's more of a flowing of between team members going on. And then the next one would be rotating leadership. Everybody takes initiative and a role in producing results and communicating. And then the last one is the self-directed. So you have an outside leader who is then commissioning a group of people to work together and is basically just collecting at the very end on the product. For virtual team building, what research has found is most effective is the rotating and the shared leadership. It doesn't mean that the team leader, the appointed team leader, is giving up leadership completely, but what happens here is each team member gets a turn on conducting and managing a virtual team meeting or a part of the product so that everybody has ownership. Everybody knows eventually I'm going to have to step up to the plate. Eventually, I will have to be the one who is going to be in charge of moving the project forward. And it's also a beautiful way of drawing people out that normally are more quiet. So when you think about virtual teams or even teams on around one conference table, extroverted people are usually the one who love to speak up and who are very much heard and visible, whereas introverts really want to think longer about questions, and they may have their most brilliant idea outside of the meeting room. By rotating leadership or the facilitation of online meetings between different people, you allow introverted people to really think about what they would want to present, and you will have access to all the different voices and all the different ideas. So it works really well. So we are going to now move on to mega mistake number two, and that is treating all team members the same. Sounds really great in our current environment where everybody is really on its toes, especially in the Washington, D.C. area, to be politically correct. And it seems to be the safest to just treat everyone the same. And you're really losing all the advantages of the differences that teams have to offer. So we're having somebody call in from Oregon. You will enjoy this particular slide. Let's say you're creating a unique virtual team and you have team members participate from different parts of the country. And without having to really decode it for you, you probably have a sense of Olympia, Oregon, operating and thinking and having a different value system than somebody coming from or calling in from New Orleans or somebody who is working in the Washington, D.C. area. And there's really no right or wrong, and you still have to consider that people in their natural environments will probably be supported in a common way of thinking, of belief systems, of handling issues. And they all need to come together in your shared space, in the virtual space, and they need to have ownership over it. So it's really important to acknowledge the differences and acknowledge where people are coming from and together create a shared space where everybody feels, okay, we're now creating something new. We're not just taking blue and operating the blue way of thinking, or we're not just taking the red way of thinking and operating. We're creating something that is unique to our group. We enjoy this space, we feel safe in this space, and we share ideas in that space. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later on in the presentation. If you take that whole idea global, that people come from different areas, they have different preferences, they have different perspectives, it becomes even more interesting and potentially also more challenging. This is just an overview. I'm not going to address every single one of those cultural dimensions that were developed by Gerd Hofstadter. Let's just pick one out, for example, on the individualism versus collectivism. Very clear, America is very, very high on individualism. It's all about the individual versus China and Taiwan, where everything is about the collective. So group dynamics with individualists will look very different from group dynamics for people growing up or being accustomed to a collectivist thinking. And it's just something that needs to be taken into consideration when you build your team, so that when you create this shared purple space, that everybody feels comfortable and every voice is invited and every perspective is being considered. So if anybody has questions about that, please feel free to shoot them along, and we'll wrap them up all the way at the end. Mega mistake number three, mistaking virtual connections for virtual closeness. And I think you probably can all relate. We have a gazillion people that we're virtually connected with on LinkedIn accounts, but do we really know them as a person? Do we really know what their strengths are? Who in our network do we know to call when we have an issue or when we need to connect people? It's really the people that we have a close relationship with. So just having a virtual connection with your team members, and again, using technology to connect with them, really is not enough in order to create a team spirit and a sense of we really belong together and we have a shared mission and a shared vision and also an urgency created for us. So now I'm giving you two examples where other companies have successfully addressed that issue. One is if you have a picture and a sense of where people are located and you know a little bit about the different countries and the different work environments, it is so much easier to relate to them. So if I know I'm talking to somebody in Mexico or if I'm talking to somebody in China, I know time differences, I have a sense of what their work environment may look like, what their physical environment looks like, maybe what even what their political context is within which they have to operate. And this company put it all together on a beautiful globe map. You can, of course, do that for the United States as well, so that you get a sense of where your team members are located. And if this was an interactive screen, you could click on a headshot and then you get just a little bit of a bio and a personal feel for that person as well. So as you're talking with people in the virtual space on a conference call, you have actually a graphic illustration on where are they located, what makes them special, how are they related to the organization, and it makes it a lot easier to then invite for feedback or invite for additional ideas as you are discussing issues. Another way that this company has dealt with it, this is an overview of a team charter. So when you're at the beginning of developing a team and you want to create this shared purple space, this is a great way of doing that. They used a facilitator to help them with drawing all of these things out. And you are creating your own culture. You're creating how do you want to be treated? What is an accepted behavior in our group? What is not accepted? What are our needs and expectations? What do we value as individuals? You can see all Anna's little stickies are all green, so you can kind of follow her around in all these different areas. What does she do really well? What is she known for? What are some weaknesses where maybe a team member can step in and support her and help her to either strengthen her skills or to just take over things that she's really not, that are not her strong suits. So this is a beautiful way as a kickoff way. You can do that virtually. You don't have to be in the same space, but it certainly would be easier if you can facilitate a group meeting at the beginning. But you can do this virtually on places like Google Docs. You can share a same document that is interactive where you can do that exercise together. And it's a beautiful way of getting to know each other and really creating a team spirit and a sense of what do we want to accomplish as a team and where are our strengths. So these were the three mistakes, and later on I'll give you a recap of all of that so that we'll have it front and center. I'm just checking in with you to see if there's any questions or comments about the mistakes. Have you seen that in your workspace? How have you dealt with it? Those would be interesting things to hear. So we'll see if Sarah has any comments. Sarah, feel free to interrupt me or add to the presentation as things come up.
Sure. So we've gotten a couple questions and some feedback also from folks who have been describing their telework situations. And it's great to hear the diversity on the line and kind of the positions you all are in. So a couple questions for you, Friederike, up to this point. So a big question about how to motivate people, creating that sense of urgency, but also how to motivate people that the work being done or listening to fellow colleagues on the team is really important, and motivating people to keep priority and pay attention to fellow attendees who are working remotely instead of checking emails or checking their phones or being elsewhere. How do you create that sense of staying present in a virtual team? From some of the questions coming in, that seems to be a huge issue.
Okay, that's a great question. Frequency and touching base and coming together as a team is absolutely key. So it depends on the issue. It depends on team availability and also maturity of the team. At the very beginning, it may be beneficial to meet every week at a certain time. And then also to account for time zone differences to share the burden of different time zones. So if you really truly have a global team, everybody needs to bite the bullet at one point and be online at 3 o'clock in the morning so that it's not just resting with one team. And that will, gestures like that to really account for different environments will make people, will make different team members feel acknowledged and appreciated. That is one way of doing it. But the frequency of really coming online together as a team in at the same time is crucial. You want to be able to hear different voices. You want to be able to have the feeling I can rely on my colleagues. One team that I worked with, they instituted that everybody is kind of passively online on Skype during a certain time of the day, so that if somebody has a question, it doesn't have to be a long email. You can just send a quick ping, and you know if my button is turned on green, that you're allowed to interrupt me. And that way, they felt like they had immediate access to somebody who was not in the same room. Kind of what you would do in a physical shared office space, where you walk over to your colleague's desk and you say, "Hey, do you have a minute? I have an issue. I have a question." And you can create the same type of environment online by agreeing on being present and allowing people to interrupt you and letting them know how to get in touch with you. So that's a great way of doing that. And then if you know that your colleagues are all online at a particular time during the day, you can really streamline your work around that and organize that around that instead of just pinging whenever it comes to your mind. So it requires some organization on your part to collect your questions and your issues, but then you can bring it to the whole team, which has been really effective for the teams that I've been working with.
That's great. Just some feedback from someone joining us that they've used the photos with their global team as a great icebreaker, and people included pictures of their families and their pets. And so it was just a great way to create this sense of community and closeness. So that seems like a great tool. Another question for you, Friedrich. This comes to us from Eric, who says that he's brand new to virtual teams and he starts tomorrow. He's asking, assuming that the team doesn't have a charter, what would be the best way as a new team member to suggest creating one?
So here we are having a typical technology issue and that you cut out for a couple of seconds. And I think that was at the most important part of the question. So I need to ask you to repeat it one more time.
Oh, so sorry. So a question about being brand new to virtual teams, in fact, starting the position tomorrow. So coming in brand new and assuming that the team doesn't have a charter, how would a person who is brand new suggest creating one to members, fellow members of the team?
That is a great question. And I would just come out straight out and say, can we all spend a couple of minutes to write down or put together how we would like to operate? I've done that for very short temporary teams, even if it's just a classroom situation, whether it's a virtual classroom or whether that's a physical classroom, to say, what are the do's and don'ts that we as a group want to observe? What is important to us? And then the whole group participates. So one person may chime in and say, you know, I think it's really, we should agree to put our mobile devices completely away for the time that we're interacting and really make a commitment to that. Another person may say, I really would love for our conversation to be a safe space and what we discuss stays here until we all agree on a shared message that we communicate to, you know, the outside world outside of our team. So there's a whole, you can really invite all of the new team members in to say, how would you like to work together? What is really important to you? What have you found to be effective in other teams? And let's put it all in one charter. And it doesn't have to be pretty. And you will also learn, it's a great icebreaker because you, as you go through that exercise, you learn a lot about your team members and what is important to them. So that would be one easy way of putting a team charter together and get the kind of like the golden rules of your particular team and also to get to know your team members. So thank you so much for that question. That was excellent. And good luck as you're embarking on the virtual communication journey. We're having about 20 minutes left, so I want to make sure that we address the assessment of the virtual leadership effectiveness, because I personally absolutely love that tool to create more awareness around communication in teams, and that's not limited to virtual teams, that's really universal. So let's dive right into that, and then we'll have some more time for additional questions in the end, I hope. So relational communication is all about building unity, building shared mission, and executing. And there's three components to relational communication that are equally important. One is communicating for action, which includes what are the explicit conditions of satisfaction. So what we're back to expectation management around action. Who does what, when, and how, and to create agreement around that so it can be executed. That's one whole section of communication. Another whole section of communication or category, if you will, is information sharing and receiving. How do you give information and how do you receive information? What are the data, what's the data and the facts that are important to what we want to accomplish? And then really distinguish from that, what are my or my team's assessments and interpretation of the data? So many times we fall into the trap that we present opinion and package it as data. And it's really helpful to say, this is what can be measured. This is true for everyone. This is, you know, it's not just a beautiful day in Washington, D.C. today. We measure temperatures around, I don't know, upper 30s maybe right now with a couple of clouds in the sky that everybody can see, and it's a blue sky. So those things are measurable. If I just share with you online, we have a beautiful day in DC, that can mean so many different things for other people, and it's just my assessment and my interpretation. So important with giving and receiving information or collecting information is the distinction between data and facts and assessment and interpretations. The third part of relational communication is communicating to build relationships. So here you're conversing to build trust, to have shared values, to motivate, to inspire, and it's really connecting deeply with another person. And then now I'm going to put them together for you. So when you look at those three, I invite you to figure out, you know, what's my go-to area? Am I a list person? I'm all about creating action, and I get up in the morning and I break out my list and here are all of my to-dos and I just want to check them off. Am I really in love with data? I love researching. I love creating infographics or graphs or presenting ideas in information format. Or are you somebody who really thrives on relationships? You know, oh, I love connecting people. I love for them to do well and talk, you know, speak and operate at their strengths and at their best. Usually there's one area that we do really, really well, and that's our go-to thing. And then maybe there's a secondary area that we also utilize quite frequently. And a lot of times there's the third area where you really have to spend time and be intentional about it. So now if we put it together, if you combine action, if you're an action-oriented person and you love information, a lot of times the outcome is innovation. You know, you're all about creating something new or falling into action. You're utilizing information and something new comes about. If you put together information and relationships, so you have the data, you have the people, you create vision and you're creating buy-in and you're creating something on the horizon that together as a group you shoot towards. And if you're combining relationships and action, it's all about collaboration. You know, I know what your strengths are. We need to get this done. You do this, I do that. And together we can, you know, really move mountains. So this is where, you know, you create so much more than if you were just doing it on your own. If you put all three together, this is where it really becomes magical, where you create optimal results and where innovation, vision, collaboration, all of that comes together. So as you were thinking at the beginning, when you see the three individual circles and you were thinking about what's my go-to response? What's my go-to or secondary? I'm really comfortable with that, but I don't think about, you know, the third one. Just see what you could have if you were equally employing all three. One thing that happens in virtual teams a lot is you're all about action. You're all about sharing information, making information accessible. You use all sorts of online tools where people can access data, and you have your action plan, and the relationships are harder to build virtually. And that a lot of times that just gets neglected. And it's not that people don't think it's important, but the other two are so much easier to do well. So, and here is what happens when you neglect it. You're really losing your collaboration power, and you're losing the sense of urgency, the sense of shared vision, the sense of we're all in this together. And this is where, if you want to create urgency, pay attention to relationships. What is important to your different team members? How can you bring what is important to them and what their needs are and what their wants are and their motivations are together? Recognize it and then bring their relationship into your project. I'm just going to flip through the others a little bit faster because you kind of get the message. If you are not much about action and you stay in information and relationship building, you're losing. And the same happens if you don't pay attention to information sharing, especially with a virtual team. You're all about action and collaboration. You're really losing your advantage and your edge here. So putting it all back together, that is really the ultimate goal of a virtual leader, is to use all three circles equally well. And if you already know about yourself that you tend to neglect one over the other, or you're just not as well versed in it, that's where you really need to pay attention and work on your skills and improve. So next step forward, to expand your growth as a virtual leader, I'm inviting you after the presentation, go back and write down those questions or think about those questions and spend some time. You know, how would you create meaningful connections in your team and in your professional environment so people are able and willing to freely share information and ideas? Because that's really where the virtual team can shine, when you can bring that to fruition. And what components of the relational communication triad come natural to you? Where do you see a benefit to strengthen underutilized communication skills, and how would you go about doing that? So I invite you to go back and really spend some time with those questions and journal about it maybe. So my invitation to you, I know that we're had to kind of brush over some things quickly, but all of the participants in the seminar or in the webinar today, I created a fast link to schedule a half-hour consultation session with me. I would love to hear about your issues in your workplace. Maybe we can do a quick strategy on how to improve or how to shift things around for you that would work in your particular case. I always love to hear what works and what doesn't in the field. I really thrive on feedback. So that's my invitation. Come to that short link and schedule your half hour session with me if you like. So here's a quick recap. I don't want to just leave you with a myth, but also offer you the myth buster. Building a successful virtual team starts with you. It's really all about expanding your own leadership skills and capacities, and they will serve you well whether you work with an in-house team, whether you work with a virtual team or a mixture, or if you're working with telecommuting colleagues or people that report to you. It really starts with you and your communication skills. Mythbuster number two, virtual teams have the potential to outperform in-house teams because you're drawing on fresh insight. You're drawing on people who are not completely enmeshed in the water cooler conversations in one physical location where gossip can go rampant and people have opinions about everything, and you start to have there's a danger of starting to have groupthink. Virtual teams are great with really drawing on fresh perspectives, and they do have the potential to outperform if they're led well and with intention. Mythbuster number three, your ability to create a shared space is more important than the technology you use. So the intention and the focus really needs to be on how do I bring, or in what way do I bring my team together, and how do we share a vision, and how do we get to know each other well, and what technology would serve us, and not pick the technology and then figure out how to manage your team around it. So tip number one to avoid mistakes is communicate clear expectations and share leadership responsibilities in virtual teams. That's how you create engagement. It's not just one person talking to you. Unfortunately, our webinar is not as interactive as I would love it to be. I would love to see all of your faces. I would love to see where you all are located and be able to speak to your particular situation. 1 hour, of course, is not enough, but when you're working with a longer-term virtual team, shared leadership responsibilities and inviting people to speak and give them a lot of time to speak is really important. Tip number two, leverage different perspectives and strengths in your team. Again, goes back to really get to know your team member. Know who is good in certain areas and who you can call on when certain situations arise. And every person, every professional has different strengths and maybe different weaknesses. But if you can really employ and apply your team so that everyone works towards their strength and towards what they're passionate about, you will be amazed what kind of mountains you can move with your team. Tip number three, create a vision and a work environment that people want to be part of. If you feel like you have a global family and you're excited about somebody's first baby being born in Brazil, and you can feel passionate about something that's going on for a team member in Australia, or something else is happening for somebody in New York, and you have this human-to-human connection where you are aware of their work environment and you are aware of them as a whole human being, that really creates a space where you enjoy sharing and you feel safe of having crazy ideas. You also feel safe to admitting mistakes and allowing your team members to support you. So just that human-to-human connection is extremely important. It's important in an in-house environment, but it's even more so important to be intentional about that in a virtual environment. Just a little funny story on the side. I have seen other team members really walk around with their mobile phones and take their whole team from their desk to their water cooler and introduce other members that work in their remote location, or they took a short video. What does my commute to work look like? And it's so amazing to be on a cab drive with somebody going through New Delhi during rush hour. And all of these things are helping to connect with people and to get a sense of where they're coming from and what impacts their decision-making skills, what impacts their just their perspectives and their belief system. So that was a quick recap. And now it's time for, yay, we have 5 more minutes for additional Q&A. So now it's really for you. The door is open. I would love to hear feedback on the presentation. What did you like? What worked for you? Where do you have additional questions? And I'll turn it over to Sarah to moderate that part.
Sure. Thank you so much, Friedrich. Several questions have come in. So one is about check-ins. So if you have a weekly or a bi-weekly check-in, if you're working remotely, that's obviously a really important time to be able to share updates with your manager and let them know what's going on, not only big picture, but small picture too. How do you avoid those check-in meetings from becoming overwhelming and lasting, you know, for multiple hours to 2+ hours or longer? How do you navigate those check-in meetings?
So I've seen it work really well in teams if you appoint a tangent police person. A tangent police person means that, you know, that's the person and it's a rotating role. No, nobody ever gets to stay stuck with it. But it's kind of that person has the authority during a meeting to say, we're getting off on a tangent. You know, we're allotting 2 minutes updates for each team member. And once the 2 minutes are up, we need to move on so that you have one person who really manages the volume of information so that you don't get too deep into the weeds. What I have seen effective also, if a conversation comes up that is important, but that is really only important to team members, that tangent police person can then also say, you know what, this is really an important, or the leader can come up and say, this is an important issue. Let's discuss that at another time between those team members. That is really not important to the whole team. Thank you for bringing that up. That's an important issue. Let's move on. So that way you really keep a crisp pace of the meeting. Important to have an agenda, of course. So no meeting should ever, whether that's in person or not in person, no meeting should ever take place with clear intentions and a clear agenda of what people want to accomplish during that meeting, and to have a flow established so that if something new comes up, people know when they can speak up, and everybody has a sense of orderliness. And then going back to shared leadership, as you have different roles of moderating, reporting, policing, you take turns on stepping in those different roles, and that works really well.
Great. How would you apply what you've shared here, or do you have any insight or tips as to how to manage teams that are virtual, but they are all volunteers, they're not paid employees?
That is a great question. I participate in various volunteer organizations, and we have just recently switched to virtual call-in meetings, which is wonderful because then that way you cut down on commuting time and spending, you know, time in traffic. It is also a lot more challenging to do this well. One thing that we have changed in one group is we do have a roster with pictures for everyone and names, and so that we know and people announce themselves. So if I have a contribution to make, then I say, my name here, yeah, this is Frederica speaking, I have this and that idea, and people then on the side know, have a face with my name. For a volunteer organization, it's really important to keep everybody engaged, that the mission is crisp and clear. Why are we coming together? Why are we meeting today? And that goes back to being clear on your agenda and what you want to move forward, and to make sure that everybody in the team has a role to play and that the role also is in alignment with their strengths. So I hope that answers some of your questions. And I do realize that we're coming up on the hour. I just wanted to flip through, not through, but here are some resources that you can go back to and pull up. I love that book, Closeness at a Distance, that was put together by German team of researchers and consultants, and it's absolutely fantastic for a much more in-depth discussion of what makes virtual teams successful. And then there's a couple of shorter online material that you can read. And again, my invitation stands. I know that we're out of time for the webinar and everybody's busy. So I want to honor that commitment. If you do have questions, I love talking with people. I love to hear what works, what doesn't work. Please come and visit me. Schedule your appointment at explorevirtualleadership.com. You can check my work out on butlercommunication.com. Would love to hear from you, connect with you, and I wish you all the best as you're stepping out into the world, as you're working with telecommuters, as you're working with nationally dispersed team members, or maybe even globally, and it can be done. So start with yourself, start with your own leadership skills and your own courage and your own clarity on what you want to accomplish with your team, and you can get there. It's not rocket science, but it does take work and it takes continuous learning.
Thank you so much, Friederike. This has been so wonderful. Really appreciate you sharing all your expertise and insights. Everybody, I'll be including the links that Friederike shared here at the end of her presentation with you all in the webinar follow-up email. And I'll also be including a link to the recording of this presentation so that you can reference it whenever you like. So please do follow up with Friederike, get in touch. Thank you again so much for being with us today. Really, really appreciate you taking your time. Wishing everybody a wonderful, beautiful Thursday and a happy weekend. Thank you again. Thank you.